Hello, today we are going to discuss about the use of experiential learning in social sciences. As you're aware, social sciences being a very interdisciplinary and a very rich field, wherein experiences play a very critical role in learning. Unless we are able to teach such that whatever we teach, we are able to relate to the experiences of the learner, learning doesn't become meaningful. They do not relate to what they have learned. So as teachers, it is our primary duty to involve students in experiential learning through activities, through giving them experiences by field visits, such that they are able to learn by their experiences. Forming curricular connections with real life experiences makes the subject not only vibrant, interesting, but also makes it more meaningful and joyful in the long run. It also makes conceptual clarity a very easy task for the teacher while the student has engaged in any kind of experience. Let us begin now by looking at a famous Chinese proverb. Tell me and I'll forget. Show me and I may remember. Involve me and I'll understand. If we look at this quote, if you just, you know, you're verbally telling a child something, the child may forget, right? And if you are looking at concrete materials, you show the child a demonstration or something, then the child will remember. But for understanding, you have to involve the child. That's what it means. Involve the child in activities, involve the child in real life experiences, such that you can form curricular connections with what you are learning. Now, Dewey's main concern in education was a big gap between the experiences of a child and the concept imposed upon him in the formal education setup. As you're all aware, John Dewey is famous for pragmatism, the entire philosophy of pragmatism which he gave, and wherein he talks that it's very, very important that any education which is given to the child is related to the experiences of the child. Otherwise, there is a disconnect between what you are teaching the child and what the child is able to understand. So we have to bridge this gap between the experiences of the child and what is the discourse in the classroom teaching learning. He believed that this disparity stunts a child's natural experiences and abilities, forcing him or her to fall in line in the formal education system without questioning what constitutes his or her context. And this makes learning very dull and very monotonous, right? Because if you keep the child learning in a classroom very away from his or her natural experiences, the child will have no choice but to, you know, just keep on repeating either rote memorizing and not forming any kind of connections with what he's learning. And many a times children do not even know why are they being taught what they're being taught and how will it be useful in their future lives? How will they use that learning in life per se, right? So Dewey further says that experience occurs continuously because the interaction of the live creature and environing conditions is involved in the very process of living. See, we all experience life day in and day out. It is a continuous process. You are interacting with your environment and you are very involved in the process of living. While you are living, your day-to-day life experiences, right, become a part of your own learning. And Dewey says, development means transformation. That reconstruction or reorganization of experience, which adds to the meaning of experience and which increases the ability to direct the course of subsequent experience. So that means through my experiences, whatever I learn today, I'm able to understand that through that experience, and those experiences help me to understand my reality in future, right? So once you have prior experience, the next experience, you are able to find connections with your experiences, and thus you are able to understand your reality better, right? So ultimately what it is, you are understanding and learning by the reorganization of your experiences, making your learning more concrete, more meaningful, and long-term. Now, experiential learning, as the term suggests, is a strategy used in learning by experience. That means when you're talking of experiential learning, you're basically talking of learning by your experiences. Now, with respect to use of experience learning in social sciences, we need to understand that the teacher has to very carefully think What are the kind of experiences? What are the variety of experiences? What is the diversity of experiences I would like to give my learners to understand a particular concept, right? So we have to choose which are the experiences I would like to expose my learners such that, you know, the experience becomes very meaningful and is central to the very, you know, task of learning. Now, this strategy allows for field work, connecting learning to real life situations. Here you can use concrete experiences to understand the new ideas and concepts and use the feedback to validate the new concept. For example, when you're talking of experiential learning, suppose you're talking or teaching about democracy. So a democracy in action, you may start with the process of choosing a government. You may begin with understanding the dynamics of elections. You may take the students for a visitation to an election commission's office. Let them understand the nuances of how the commission works to, you know, ensure free and fair elections. Another thing, for example, you're teaching the hierarchy with reference to how a particular ministry works. So you may take them to the ministry and show them the different parts of the different departments so that they see how exactly the working of a particular governance system takes place. So these kind of experiences are very, very important. For example, in economics, if you're teaching banking, now it's very, very important to take the students to a bank. Let them see how different people facilitate the customers in the bank and how their roles and responsibilities are distributed and how the work takes place. How has banking changed over the years? All this is a part of experiential learning. For example, in history, just imagine looking at monuments through pictures and having an experience by going to the particular monument. They are very different things, right? If you're talking about, for example, the Qutub Minar, or if you're talking about the Taj Mahal, or if you're talking about the Humayun's tomb, so on and so forth, you need to not only show them the pictorial representations, but in order to appreciate the art, the architecture, the history behind them, it is important that you take them for field visits. Through these field visits, when they experience through the field visit, the monument, its architecture, you know, how the entire monument has been built, the history behind it and the economics behind it and the social context which was there. You know, you can have an entire itinerary drawn wherein you tell the students to have a pre-research module in place so that they research about the monument, and then you take them to the monument so that they are able to appreciate whatever they have learnt in theory. So this strategy allows for field work, connecting learning to real life situations. Here you can use concrete experiences to understand the new ideas and concepts and to use the feedback to validate the new concept. So it's very, very important that through experiences, the learners are able to understand the concepts which are being taught. Going further, now, experiential learning particularly is the process of making meaning from direct experience. It focuses on learning process for the individual. For example, an example of experiential learning we just discussed is going to the parliament and learning through observation and interaction with the functionaries there to understand the working of a parliamentary democracy, as opposed to reading about it from a book. I am able to look at the book, I can see facts, I can, you know, just pick up concepts, but to understand and relate to those concepts, the first-hand experience is the best. Wherever you can give the first-hand experience, learning becomes very, I would say, concrete, and you're able to retain what you have learnt by making connections. You do not forget because you have been involved in that experience. Thus, one makes discoveries and experiments with knowledge first-hand. Instead of hearing or reading about others' experiences, you may hear stories, you may hear narratives, but there are some things where experiential learning works best. So the teacher has to carefully select that which are the concepts where direct experience can be made a part of the teaching learning exercise. Meaning making becomes easier if the individual has direct experience with reference to the concept being elucidated by the teacher. Now, experiential learning can be highly effective educational method provided it is done in a very systematic manner. Provided you choose that these are the kind of experiences I would like to give my learners very carefully, right? And when you organize that experience also has to be organized very systematically such that it becomes meaningful for the learner. That means a lot of homework goes in before, you know, exposing the child to any kind of experience or the student to any kind of experience. For example, if you're taking them for a parliamentary visit, you have to have all the preparations in hand. You have to tell them which house you would be visiting. In, for example, in case of India, whether you're taking them to the Lok Sabha, whether you're taking them to the Rajya Sabha, what are the protocols they would have to observe? What are the what is the behavior which is expected of them? What may they observe there? Let them be mentally prepared with what they may observe there. And then ask them to maintain a reflective journal, write about their experiences. And then you can brainstorm on those experiences so that learning becomes very meaningful and they are able to understand what exactly did they engage with in terms of this experience. So experiential learning engages the learner at a more personal level by addressing the needs and wants of the individuals. Experiential learning requires qualities such as self-initiative and self-evaluation. The process of experiential learning allows one to learn new skills, new attitudes, or even entirely new ways of thinking. Because while you experience, you think about what you're observing, you critically reflect on your experience, right? You may pick up many values through those experiences. For example, if you're teaching poverty, right, in social science, and you take them to a locality where, you know, you find that people who are economically marginalized are living, let them understand the, you know, the exact pain behind deprivation, how privileged they are, and in terms, empathize, right? Empathize that and how they can make a difference to the lives of other people around them. And how they can also take onus of responsibility to become agents of transformation of this social reality together, right? Let them interact with people of different communities. Let them interact with people of different castes, different regions, different communities, such that they also understand the concept of multiculturalism and multilingualism and, of course, diversity in all its forms. India being a very plural society, it is very, very important for students to understand that we live in a place which is so diverse, and this diversity is to be appreciated and is to be respected by all means. It is a land where we all, with different languages, with different castes, from different races, from different social backgrounds, from different economic backgrounds, live together in harmony. And this is the essence of the social fabric of our country. So these kind of experiences where you expose them to different cultures through interactions in the field enable the student to understand the different constitutional values which are enshrined in the Constitution of India. Whether it's the value of justice, whether it's about freedom, right? Whether it's about equality, we are able to show them in action, and thus they are able to appreciate these values, develop positive attitudes to inculcate the same, and of course learn new skills by moving in the field. Moving further, experiential learning can be highly effective as an educational method. As we discussed, it engages the learner at the personal level by addressing the needs and wants of the individual. Because you are involved in what you're learning, you are able to relate to what you're learning, and thus you are able to understand the dynamics of what you're learning. So that is extremely important, that these experiences are picked up by the teacher very carefully, that what are the kind of experiences in this particular lesson which will make this lesson more worthwhile, more interesting, and help in the retention of concepts. So the role of the teacher here is to facilitate the experience such that learning becomes meaningful. Now, it requires qualities of self-initiative and self-evaluation. That means when you take the students for the experiential learning exercises in the terms of field visits, etc. Not only do the students need to have this self-initiative to go in the field and learn, the teacher also needs to have the self-initiative to look at how the experiential learning process is moving, so that the teacher works as a facilitator in this. And of course, when you go for experience, self-evaluation is also very, very important. That means you have to think, what did you learn from this experience? How did this experience change you from what you were in terms of attitudes, in terms of skills, in terms of values, in terms of knowledge pools, so on and so forth. So self-evaluation is also very, very important in this. Now, the process of experiential learning allows one to learn new skills, new attitudes, or even entirely new ways of thinking, right? Many a times when you go for field visits and what you see there, it changes the way you think. It changes your attitude. It changes the way you perceive the world. So your social reality changes through your experiences, right? It is true that an important role is played by experience in the learning process. So a fun learning environment with plenty of laughter and respect for learners' abilities also fosters an effective experiential learning environment. Now, when you say a fun-loving environment with plenty of laughter and respect for learners' abilities, that means when you're talking of, you know, having experiences such that the learner is able to make curricular connections, you need to decide or think of the age group of the learners, the interest of the learners, the abilities of the learners, so that their potential is driven to the peak, brought it to the peak, and they learn effectively. You have to have activities, you have to have field visits, which are not only connected to the curriculum, but are also interesting. Students feel involved. So for that, it is also very important that you distribute roles and responsibilities to each one of them before they undertake any kind of experience. For example, if you're talking of sustainable development, if you're talking of conservation, it's very, very important that all of them are involved in a conservation activity together. For example, if you say that they need to be involved in an environmental concern such as rainwater harvesting, and how would they increase the awareness in their local communities with reference to rainwater harvesting and with respect to conservation of water, you might form small groups and let them go to the community, give them a questionnaire, give them a write-up, such that they are able to go door to door, conduct surveys whether the rain harvesting systems are in place or not, and also make people aware with reference to the advantages of rainwater harvesting with reference to conservation. So it's extremely important that the activity itself with reference to the experiences which you are giving them becomes very interesting, and it is an activity which students enjoy. They enjoy being together, learn as a team through those experiences, which of course are connected to the curriculum. One has to be very, very careful when you're talking about experiential learning. Let it not just be a fun activity with no curricular connections. It should not be a pleasure trip if you're talking of the field trips, but it has to be something where they understand what they are doing and why they are doing and how it is connected to the curriculum, right? So, for example, if you're teaching them the working of or the governance done by a panchayat, it's important that they are taken to a village and they see the working of the panchayat in action, that how they look at different roles and responsibilities, how roles and responsibilities are distributed, and how exactly do the members of the panchayat work together in making their village governance better day by day, right? Such that when they read about the panchayat, they are able to form connections with reference to what exactly the panchayat does in a village, right? So it's important that these curricular connections help them to understand. So whenever you're going to talk about the panchayat, this child can immediately form connections because the child has gone to the village and seen that. So that experience will stay with the child for an entire lifetime, right? Moving further, an effective teacher is the one who practices experiential learning and is passionate about his or her work. He or she is able to immerse participants totally in the learning situation, allowing them to gain new knowledge from their peers and the environment created. These teachers stimulate the imagination, keeping participants hooked on the experience. In addition to standard written and visual materials, learners with different types of learning styles and strengths can be accommodated by providing direct experience. So experiential learning enables one to understand what you are learning by making these connections, and an effective teacher is the one who enables learners to form these connections, and it becomes an experience to remember for a lifetime, thus making their learning meaningful, and they're able to, you know, absolutely understand that what exactly does this experience mean for me? How will I use this experience in my life further? How will this learning benefit me as a learner? Because most of the times when learners are not able to connect to their social reality or to their life experiences, they really don't know why they are studying, what they are studying, and what use it will. And as a result, they forget after some time, or they resort to rote memorization just for examinations, which makes the entire exercise of education futile. So let's together make social sciences a fun-loving place, a place where students learn through their experiences inside and outside the classroom, and it becomes a joyful and meaningful experience for each one of them. So I hope each one of you is going to indulge in experiential learning in social sciences. Let us move further with reference to the process involved in experiential learning once again. While using this strategy, you have to first identify the concept which has scope for fieldwork or observation, right? Plan for fieldwork and provide as far as possible first-hand experience to students. Thirdly, based on their experiences, get the feedback and pool the information. It's very, very important. Let the students arrive at the meaning of the concept and processes, if any. And finally, create a context for validation of the acquired new concept, right? If they've gone for a field visitation, they've experienced something, it's important that based on their experiences, whether it's in the form of a reflective journal, whether you brainstorm together what you have learned, and what exactly does this concept mean for them now, and how has the concept changed through this experience, it's very important that this validation takes place, right? So it's important that once this experiences have been undertaken by the learners, they discuss it threadbare such that learning takes place. Okay, now let me illustrate the concept experiential learning through a few examples. For example, if you're talking of the concept of governance, you have to begin with understanding that what are the different, you know, realms of governance and how exactly does a government govern. So telling them about the different parts of the executive, the judiciary, okay, then you move on to lawmaking, and it's important that you take them to the parliament, you take them to the court. It's important to look at how the civil society operates, for example, what is the role of the police station, so on and so forth, and how exactly effective governance by the different ministries is undertaken, right? So the entire concept can be illustrated by taking them to the field through field visitations, right? Another example which you may take, for example, in social sciences, if it's if you're teaching geography, right? And in geography, if you're talking of different kinds of soils, so you can take them to the field, let them see the different kinds of soils, right? And if you feel that the different kinds of soils are not located in one particular, so you can take them, for example, in Delhi, you can take them to Indian Agricultural Research Institute, where they have samples of different kinds of soils, and they may experience that. Or with reference to if you are teaching about agricultural practices or agricultural produce, let them go to the field and see, okay? For example, if you are teaching the wholesaler and the retailer and all those concepts about in economics, for example, take them to the market, take them to a wholesaling place, take them to the retailers and then to the shopkeepers, and let them experience this chain and how the good entirely exactly reaches the consumer. So it's important to illustrate this concept by experiential learning. You know, not giving them the experiences, many of us, you know, while we grow up, we do not even know how exactly the bank works. You start understanding about banking either when you start earning, or if by God's grace, you've been lucky and you have an account, you have to operate that account, you will learn something. But it's important to introduce this concept of banking right when you teach banking in social sciences, in economics, so on and so forth, right? So it's important that experiential learning becomes a very, very important part of the classroom discourse through and through field visits, such that learners together understand by their experiences and learning becomes concrete, joyful, and meaningful in the long run. So, I hope you have understood the meaning of experiential learning. What exactly does it mean to experience and to learn from those experiences? As teachers, the onus of responsibility lies on you to understand that experiential learning ultimately enables you to translate even abstract concepts to simple ones, because they see the reality in action, they see how the concept unfolds in front of their eyes, and as a result, they are able to appreciate it through their experiences. So, with these words, I hope experiential learning is used by you through field visitations and other concrete experiences which you may give in the classroom also. Wish all of you all the best for using experiential learning in social science teaching. Thank you very much.